Well, this is my what I've done with the collage. Now you can see this shape here. That was originally the feather, but you know, it just ends up a shape. I'm not fixated on what it is. I'm just inspired by what it could be. Now also this, we call it the shell, but it's a shape. Instead of, I've done, inspired me with this, shell, is the circular motion of it, the rhythm of it. And I've used the, you know, remember I showed you the drawings of the photocopied faces I've done? This is just them cut up. But I've sat with this and looked at it for a while, and what I'm worried about is it looks like two separate things. And I was going to carry a bit of this over there, like this, like maybe move a bit of that over there to break up that thing, you know, that space. Or I was going to put a bit of this, a thin bit, and put it, strip it down there so it'll break up. But what I've come to, and I've got this bit, I've got a bit of masking tape on the back, or you could use blue tack. But blue tack's really bad now. They've changed the ingredients or something, and it sticks to everything, and you can never get it off. It's like concrete. So what I've decided to do to marry it, and always being aware of edges, I'm taking this here. I'm just going to stick it up now. I'm not going to actually glue it in yet. So that's what I did to have a look at it. And I wanted this cut edge so it looks like it's going underneath this shape. So you see, it's that last, it's sort of like the cherry on the cake. The last bit where you really, it takes a while, and you really got to get a cup of coffee and sit back and look at your work and see, and let it speak to you, and it's going to say in the end, this is what I need, after you've gone through all the different possibilities you can do. Okay? So we'll come back and we're going to, no, I don't know where that is, here it is. We're going to cut these up now. Oh, see this? This is what I mean about having stuff all over the place. So that photocopy of that onion bag, right, that's sitting there, and then I've cut a piece out of that for that collage, but that happened to fall on that, and I just love that. I love that surprise. Oh, that's a piece in itself, you know. And so is this, really. Like, I love that these are shapes, they're just cutouts, what, sort of remnants from the paper that I was doing. Like, this is a graphite over the black paper, but that's a work in itself. And that's what I say, don't throw things out. You've got bits and pieces left over. You can make your own cards, make little works, make a little book. There's so many things you can make. See, I made this little, this is a little collage made from coffee cups. You know, I just kept the coffee cups on a road trip. So this is a road trip, basically. And I've gone over that with shellac. That's why it's sort of like this. This I've gone over with PVA glue to protect it. So I've already done that. Okay? So, music this morning is by Katie Lang, Hymns of the 49th Parallel. I thought I was a bit male-centric. Better introduce a woman. Usually all my female singers are bawdy, too loud for now. Anyway, you see that the composition I drew out on this white, it's sort of thick, you know, the back of the electric blanket stuff. So I've cut out the different shapes, and you can see there I've arranged them on the board. Now what I like to do, so this is now a template. So these shapes, they're new shapes, so it'll transform into something else, and you'll find that as you work, you know, your subject matter, like the gift parcel, informed your drawings. Your drawings start informing your collage, and your collage will start informing your painting. Okay, and whenever you get lost, you go back to your original map, your point of reference, which is the gift parcel. So you'll go back and say, oh, that's what happened there. That's that colour there. That's that nuance. That's that shade. That's that tone, that line. Okay. But, so this is, you know, a piece of paper we did yesterday with a bit of mono and all that. And what I like to do, because I always like to stop being constipated, is how I put it, you know. So always keeping free. So I can take this template now, and I'll just put it there any way you want to put it, and then just draw around it to cut it out for a thing and for the next work. And so you're not looking at the front and going, oh, I want to save that little bit, it's so pretty or whatever. This is to stop you doing that, because usually this turns out better when you're taken out of the mix and you're not trying to control. But now I've got that, I can turn that over and do another side. So it's sort of like printmaking. You get the reverse. So you can go on two works, and always, you know, because you've got so many different paper, you can work on the same composition, doing heaps and heaps and heaps, and come up, you know, with different different works. So you're never short of something to do, or some inspiration or subject matter. You just go around the yard. So cut these out. And it's always a surprise to me too, when it turns over, I'll go, oh, look at that. I would never have thought of keeping that bit, you know. And it's really strange sometimes how a mark will inform, like, the rhythm of the thing, of the shape you're working on. It's so, like, serendipitous. And that's what I love. And that's how I work all the time, basically. So that shape is now, oh, see what I mean about serendipitous? Now, I could never have done this. See this mark down here? Now, that is like, on the original, that's the shadow of the shell, like when the lip of the shell comes out. Like, you can't control those things. So you can see, I wrapped in that. I'm surprised. That's not planned. That's not like one I did earlier. No, that's serendipitous. And like I said, you can get the reverse and all these different shapes. You don't have to use this paper. You can go in any paper, and then you start forming. Also, what you can do with these templates is put them on a canvas or another. You can put the white on, another board, bigger board, white cardboard, I mean. And like I showed you in the previous lesson, take it outside, wear a mask, wear goggles, always be safe. And spray paint that, and that'll come out white. You know, where that was, that'll be white, and the rest will be black. So it's really instantaneous. When you've sprayed it, of course, and this is black now because you've spray painted it, but when you lift it up, you've left the white mark, the stencil. But then you can use these again because they'll all be black, and put it on a white surface and glue them down. You just have multiple works. Oh, the garbage man's here. It's Monday morning, and Tassie is going off his brain. Hey, look at this. See where I put that down? Now, I hope you can see that. See, my eye goes across there, and where I've cut that out, and this beautiful, look at that there. I love that. How you can, it's always informing you, everything. Now, also what I wanted to say to you today. Now, this is my safe house. Now, I did a series, Safe House. It's based on the abolition of the Negroes in America. And what used to happen is they used to hang a 9-square quilt on a clothesline to show an escaping slave that was a safe house. And when I watched a documentary on this church that had in the panels on the roof, they had it divided up into 9 squares, which because symbolising and honouring that 9-square quilt. And I thought, that is just marvellous. That's what inspires me. Could be music, could be a line from a song, could be something like that, that a 9-square quilt was like this undercover spy thing. Well, it was the Underground Railway, they called it. So anyway, what I did for quilts, I represented the blocks of quilts. Now, there's bow tie and crossroads and all these different things. And they would know that. They spring from the slaves in America, a lot of those things. Now, this one here is called Log Cabin. Most people would have heard of that. I've heard of that, even though I'm not a quilter. I've heard of that. But in the middle of that, it's always a red square in that block, a red rectangle. Now, and you can see how even some of the stuff I've used now, this is years ago, I did these blocks representing the quilts, and I've used all collage, and some of the things I've used in this, like this here, leftovers, like I've got heaps and heaps, and it's good to do that. But this log cabin, and it's got a red door. Now, this is what's fascinating, and this is what inspires me, and this is what I just love the research. When the African Americans were freed, they painted their door red. Now, that red door symbolizes their freedom. Now, it goes right back to Deuteronomy, and when Moses led the people out of to the Promised Land. And before he led the people to the Promised Land, he wanted the houses to be, the people that were coming with them to the Promised Land, they slaughtered the lamb and put the blood on the front door so the passing angel would know that was a safe house. So that's how far this symbolism goes. So then that church that I saw the documentary of, that front door was a red door. And that today is Log Cabin. Log Cabin is safe house. And that's why it's always got a red rectangle in the middle of it. And I doubt if a lot of quilters even know that. But I just find that absolutely fascinating. What is more, like I said, I roll on organics, on serendipitous. I leave it up to the universe because I trust the universe. And I ended up through a series of unbelievable events. I ended up sitting in the pew of that church in Georgia, Savannah. Georgia, Savannah. And looking up at the ceiling, at that ceiling, it symbolized that 9-square quilt, probably about 10 years after I'd first seen the documentary. And I missed out where that church was. I didn't even know it was there. I didn't directly go there to see it. I just happened along and there it was. So that's the whole creating, isn't it? Trusting your process, not controlling it. You know, when you try and control something, you miss out on so much because what wants to be given to you is so much bigger, so much brighter, so much more exciting than what you can ever imagine. Okay? So keep creating. I'm going to probably do these later and show you the end results. But I think you can see what I've done, the stencils. I've just chopped up. They've become different shapes. Okay? But I can use this just on its own on a sheet of white paper. Whatever. Okay, it never ends. Never ends. The gift that keeps on giving. Oh, that's what I wanted to tell you about too. You know, when I teach, there's always... always when I teach them, like I said, I teach over 6 week blocks. And I always hang all the drawings up because drawing is the fundamental thing. I always go on drawing. I went through National Art School and the big thing was drawing. If you know how to draw, you know, it's such a gift. Now, I always hang all the works up around the work because they give a place energy. You can go into a room that's devoid of anything on the walls. Oh, my soul shrivels in those rooms. Oh. If you start putting drawings, everyone's drawings around the wall, you feel like dancing. It's giving off so much energy. Anyway, there's always someone that goes, no, you can't put my drawing up. I said, but that's what I do. Oh, no, you can't. And I know from that very reaction they have, and it's a reaction, not a response, two different things. A reaction, a response is the ability to be able to respond. A reaction is based on some past trauma that not even aware of. So I know that person that doesn't want to put their work up. They've done, probably been 3 years old doing a drawing and someone said, oh, what's that? Oh, that's a tree. Oh, that doesn't look like a tree. That's rubbish. So that stays deep down in the soul and forever it's rubbish. Now that same person, on about the fourth week, and the room I was teaching in had drawings everywhere. And this same person came in, because I'd put all her works on the wall too. And she came in this morning and she looked around. She's a bit early. And she said, oh, doesn't it look fantastic? Oh, it's so great. And she goes, and look at that one over there. Whose is that? And she ran up to it and stood in front of it. And she said, oh my God, it's mine. I'm going goosey telling you this. Oh my God, it's mine. And that I was a witness to her falling in love with her own expression. You could ask no more. Another story specifically to do with collage. Another class I was having here at my house in Howard. And we're into the collage stage of the process. And this woman, she won't mind me telling you this because she tells everyone herself, so I don't disclose things, but she tells everyone herself. Her name is Jerry, and she was Chinese. She was probably early 50s, something like that, not real young. Inscrutable. And into this fourth week, I knew I was losing her. I knew there was something, I was losing her. Anyway, I went up to the kitchen because I've got to do that. I've got to remove myself from the class sometimes because I end up circling like a shark and they all tense up. So it takes me a physical thing to wrench myself away and go up to the kitchen. They just think I'm having a break, but it's harder for me to be in the kitchen than to be down there with them. Anyway, she came up to me in the kitchen. She said, oh, Joe, I can't stand this. This is rubbish. This is childish crap. It's rubbish. I'm going home. I'm not coming back. Oh, I said, oh, Jerry, don't leave before the miracle happens. Come on, we'll come down and I'll steer you in another direction. Same direction, but a different course, you know. So we're still heading towards the same thing. And I do that with everybody. There's no one in my class. They're not all going the same. They're all on different roads, leading to their own end result. So I steered her off on another, you know, bit of a diversion. And the next week she came back with the two most amazing collages I have ever seen. And she was different. This inscrutable person comes back, she's slapping another collage, hey, going on the back, and brought a cake, and the release and the relief of bringing that expression up. So somewhere in her childhood, she's locked in that collage is childish rubbish. And these two amazing collages end up, that class end up having an exhibition at Gattacus in Gallery 3. And they wrote a little note next to it. Everybody absolutely loved her collages, and she had a little note there next to it about what had transpired. And see, that is the thing. The thing you resist the most is the thing that wants to come out and unify with you to be total, okay? To bring that out and create. Okay. Okay, you can see we're creating a body of work. Okay, so those shapes I showed you before, this is them. Now I've put them on a canvas and spray painted it black, just with the old Bunnings. And it's your choice whether it's flat black or gloss black, right? And just attach them and sprayed it. Now with that, you can't go over enamel paints with acrylics. But I can get into that if I want to. I can leave it like that, or I can try and make the edges sharper, or, you know, I could go over with oil pastels. There's tons of things to do. I can go into these areas with acrylic paint because that's still just the canvas, okay? Now, so these are the templates, the shapes. So I've just arranged them on canvas boards. So you can see the body of work that's developing. Here's the collage from that we did, and like I said, that piece de resistance. Whoop! That piece down there, you can see from before. Now it looked like it was split in the middle, and I didn't like that. And I had thought of different options, but I come to this. I just extended that red thread. And so it's given this rhythm and movement through the whole thing. So your eye doesn't come across here and stop at a wall like Trump's trying to build in Mexico. You know, it comes along and it flows. So I could really, if I wanted to, bring a bit more of that red, just a little bit out here. But I don't think I will. I think it's, you know, I think the rhythm says it all. Okay, and I've got we've got these two, you know, the work we started from the gift parcel, the nine squares. From the nine squares comes the collage, the shapes. We've got the collage, we've got the shapes from the collages where we can keep using them as templates. But and I want to show you this work I did. It's collage, it's called Pulse. Because you've got to, if you stand in front of it, the trouble is with paintings, I think, you know, people just walk past them. And some painting, you know, you need to stand in front of them and absorb them for a while. So I believe, well, it happens to me, if I stand in front of this one for a while, I can feel it pulsing. That's why I call it Pulse. Now that whole thing, now I've lost it, is one piece about this big. About that big. That's the image I started with, and this whole thing is based on that. So I did multiple copies, electrostatic images, photocopies of that little image in here, multiple color copies, and then chop them all up. But then I maximize them, took the two, the biggest enlargement I could, then the next enlargement, then the next one, and then the other. So there's, I think there's one, two, three, four or five different enlargements of this one thing there. And I didn't start in the middle, I left a space. I started from the outside because, and married up these rims. Remember I say marry the edges. You cannot tell where these edges are. They're married that well. They're in a really good relationship, these ones. So it's all together, and then worked my way into the middle. So that middle bit, and this is the thing I was saying before about if you're going to do a portrait or anything, don't start and develop the eyes and then go on to the nose, or start and develop the one thing in the landscape. Like, remember I said before about you know, you're given 40 acres, and I said, this is yours, 40 acres, and you go, oh no, I'll just build a fence around this lower half acre and I'll stay safe in here. But you must explore, get out of that, explore. And that bit I was showing you before, this last bit in here, I call that coming home. You've explored the whole 40 acres, you've had a marvellous time exploring, you're loose, You've been in the moment, but then you've got to come home. You're a bit tired, a bit exhausted, worn out. So you need to be more focused, then more and more focused, because the more tired and exhausted you become, the more your mind plays tricks and says, you know, oh, you know, this is rubbish. If you're working on a work and you're getting, because you're coming home to that one bit of cherry on the cake. And it's interesting to me that most accidents happen 5 kilometres from home, because the closer you get to it, the more relaxed you've become and the more accidents happen. It's like that proverb that says, the more a mountain reaches its summit, the more it opposes itself. So when you're coming home to your work, the more it will oppose you. So you've got to be really, and it's that time you go, oh, I don't care, that'll do, bang, and you'll destroy all the exploration you have done. So take your time, you've got to come right into the nanosecond. Even like I said with that, I just left it alone. I had to walk away. All these options were in my head that I could have plonked down, but I had to walk away for a couple of hours, overnight, whatever, come back, look at it, and then it speaks to me and says, what about this? And that's what I went with. So be mindful of that. So next thing we're going to go on to now is the painting, from the drawings, from the collage into the painting, okay? So that's the painting's into the fifth week, 5 and 6. Okay, hope you're sort of really excited and really getting a body of work together up to this point.